the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
We'll get you guys to stand up. Stand up as we sing, "How Great is Our God."
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and I will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise. Sing with me, see how great is our God.
Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for being our great and awesome God. And Lord, we just want to thank you for giving us this time that we can study your word together. Be in our midst, bless us all, and help us to be truly blessed and be with Pastor as he gives his presentation. And let his words be your words, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, can all be seated. Thank you. So let me see a show of hands, those of you that were here this morning. Okay, good. So I have some questions, and I know that you guys are going to know the answers to it. And there's going to be a prize for those who know the answers. Okay, so this morning we talked about CSI, the case for God. But what did Pastor say CSI really meant? Malene. Cross-scene investigation. Good job, Malene. Okay. We also talked about a certain man who translated the Bible into modern English. Does anybody remember who that is? Shahid, I saw your hand first. William Tinsdale. Very good. Oh, you guys are paying attention. I think we'll give her the point for that. Okay. And just as a sideline, how many languages did he know?
Eight.
Wow. Good job, but I didn't see any hands. What were they? Yeah, bonus. What were they? Sure.
Do you have them?
Okay. Okay, what was that, Shamoya? And one more. That was eight. Excellent. Good job, Shamoya. Shamoya. Good job. Okay. What's the shortest chapter in the Bible? Good job, Malene. Good job. And okay, here's the good one. This is a bonus. The center verse in the Bible. Oh my goodness, Malene. That's right. Good job. Good job. Pastor, do you feel good that they're paying attention? That's really good. Okay. Now, Pastor mentioned the main theme of the Bible. Can anybody tell me what the main theme of the Bible is? I saw your hand first, Clarette. Hand up, Susan. God's love. That's right. Okay. And our final question. What proves, so I want to see the first hand. What proves, hold on a second here, I can't read my own writing. What proves God exists and is the true God? Lulu, creation. Excellent. You are all excellent students. Good job. Really, really proud of you. Now we're going to turn things over to Pr.Saugh. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Camille, for leading out with passion, and the praise team as well. Thank you so much, and for leading us in that Bible trivia. It's wonderful. The knowledge of God's word is, very inspiring, and it's transforming. And thank you to the musicians as well. That's beautiful. Thank you all for coming back. I know it's always a challenge. Sabbath's one of those days, right? So what I'm thinking is this afternoon it's going to be an interactive discussion as opposed to the morning type of worship style. So interactive. So I'll be presenting question and answer. Any comments, I'd like to take it as we go along. So before we go into our study, evidence that God exists, I'm going to ask Brother Jay Beckles. He's going to bless us with a special music of meditation, and then we'll go into our study. Thank you.
Just to end where human effort is all in vain. Were it not for grace, I will tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, and I know how that will go. The battles I would face, losing the race, were it not for grace. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to a friend who took my place and ran the course that I could not. And when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile. The human effort is still in vain. Were it not for grace, I will tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to salvation up to me, and I know how that will go. The battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for
Brother Jay. Just gonna bring this down here. Get closer. Shall we bow our heads for a word of prayer as we start our study this afternoon? Let's pray together. Precious Jesus, we pause to say thank you again for the blessings of Sabbath. We're so grateful, O Lord, that we can enjoy your presence, your company, and the company of our fellow brothers and sisters, as all part of the family of God. I want to thank you for each member here, O Lord, each of my brothers and sisters. Thank you so much for our church here at Bronte, and we know that, Lord, you are doing a new and great thing here. Continue to bless us and lead us. Now, as we open your words, open our minds to receive your words with gladness and joy. Inspire us, O Lord, to know you more, to love you more, and to serve you more is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You know, I want to share with you one of the reasons why we're doing this series. It's very critical because we're living in a time where so much attack, so much assault on the Bible, on God, and the church. And it's undermining our faith. It's undermining our beliefs. And it's a subtle, not even subtle anymore, but it's eroding a lot of people's faith and foundations. And there's a text in Psalm 11, verse 3. I want to just share that before I begin, just to preface this presentation. Psalm chapter 11, verse 3. This is a fundamental and foundational text and reference. It says in Psalm 11, verse 3, found it, what do you say, amen? It says, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Can you think of the import of this text? What are the implications of this text? If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? If you don't know what you believe in, then you are subject to succumb to any belief that is popular, that is convincing. In fact, I've got to share with you, there is a member of my family who, before she came at Seventh-day Adventist, was a Brahmin. Have you heard of the Brahmins? Brahminites? Brahmins, they believe in Brahmin. Kind of polytheistic religion. They believe in Brahmin as kind of emerged from or kind of a sectarian part of Hinduism. And she became a Seventh-day Adventist. And she was Seventh-day Adventist for about 15 years. And then she got some knocks on the doors, and Jehovah Witness came to visit her. And she was in a relationship with family, with my uncle and all that, and things didn't go well. And then somehow she started to gravitate toward the Jehovah Witnesses. And then within 3 to 6 months, she started going to their Kingdom Hall, and she left the church. Now, you've probably known people who have left the church. You thought that they were grounded and they knew what they believed in, and they drifted or shifted in their thinking, in their theology. And that's the reason why it's so important for us to know what we believe in and be grounded, to be rooted, to be riveted, because it's so easy. So many things are going with our young people today, you know, our youth, our students, being exposed to evolutionary thinking and thought. Then what happens? That begins to challenge our view of God. Think about that for a moment, our view of God. So let's go through some slides together. I adapted this presentation from Ron Halbrook, from a book that he wrote, Evidences for God and His Creation. Really powerful insights that he shares. So, let's see. Psalm 19, verse 1. The universe declares that God exists. Let's see what Psalm 19, 1 says. The heavens declare, can we read it together? The heavens what? And the firmament showeth His handiwork. Boy, do you want to just hit those lights up there? Just these two lights. Thank you so much. Thank you. So, the heavens make it clear that, and we look up, when you look at the stars, you ever think about how those stars get there? Those stars are millions of miles away. Millions, like millions and millions of miles away. Yet they're able to shine so brightly. They still are able to illuminate so that we can see it with our eyes, with our naked eyes. And it's so fascinating. The sun is the largest and the nearest star in our galaxy, in our solar system. How many of you know how far the sun is from the earth? 93 million miles. That's right. 93 million miles. You remember that? That is, wow. What if it was a million mile closer? If it was, you know, 1 degree closer or 1 degree further? Again, we talk about a God who is so intelligent and who knows exactly what it takes to support life. And we mentioned that this morning. Couldn't just evolve and find itself there and for the rest of the planets to revolve in its orbit and around the sun. Many ask, how may I know God exists? Well, some things are known by evidence without sight and touch. Not by telescope or microscope, not the atom or intelligence, but love. Ancient people left evidence that God exists, and overwhelming evidence that God exists. Let's keep building our case. We're in a case study here. So, Psalm 19 reveals undeniable evidence that God exists. The heavens declare the glory of God, and affirm it showeth His handiwork. God's glory is in His creation. If we continue in that chapter, verses 1 through 6, it reveals God's glory in His creation. What is the most beautiful thing in this world that you admire, appreciate? What is one thing? Give me an example of one thing that when you see it, when you spend time or you're there, it really makes you think. It changes your perspective. Any examples?
Nature.
Okay? Thank you. Yes?
A rainbow.
I wonder if you like rainbows. Okay. Do you remember the rainbow? It's mentioned in the Bible, right? And when did the rainbow appear? And what was God's reason for sending that rainbow? What was it? Amen. It was called a covenant sign because God is a covenant-keeping God. And Psalm 50 says, when He comes, gather my children, my saints together, those who have what? Made a sacrifice to me, no, made a covenant with me by what? Sacrifice. Psalm 50, I think verse 3. So He's a covenant keeper. So every time you see a rainbow, it is a reminder of God's pledge of love. That number one, He won't destroy this earth ever again with a flood. But then it's also a covenant sign between us and Him. And so people think, oh, well, yes, we can explain the physics of the rainbow. But God actually created that rainbow so that we could marvel and wonder about His greatness. God's glory is in His creation. So you said nature, you said the rainbow. Anyone else?
Butterfly.
A butterfly. What's unique about a butterfly that we admire, that's so fascinating?
It's beautiful,
but the process of transformation, the metamorphosis, crawling, yes, yes, yes. So it kind of reminds me of us. We're all like caterpillars. We're kind of creepy. We look slimy, you know, we're slimy. But you know what God does? Forms us through His Holy Spirit. He gives us wings to mount up with wings like eagles in Isaiah 40. That's right. He transforms us into His image and likeness, restoring us back so we can fly. I've seen some of the most beautiful butterflies. You've seen the monarch butterflies and the color. It's just gorgeous. How could that just evolve? A God of love, a God of intelligent design, a God who loves beauty. And part of love is to create, right? Part of love is to create. And so in His creation, He demonstrates His love. Message to all people, verses 1 through 4. And let's just read it here. It says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the what? Firmament shows His handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech, no language, where their voice is not heard. And then their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. Let's just take it on. So God's saying is that one of His revelations is nature. And those who study the book of nature should begin to understand who God is. It begins to reveal the character of God. That's if we take the time to actually study the book of nature. So we have undeniable evidence for God, God's glory in His creation, the majestic sun, which is evidence for God this morning. I referred to it. How could our solar system and our planetary system be a heliocentric universe? Did it just happen that way? God designed it that way with intentionality so that we can see the parallel. Everything in this world is to reveal who God is if we look for it. God has made it clear for people, even if they've never stepped inside of a church, if they've never even opened the Bible,
that somehow nature testifies of a supernatural being, a creator. And then it is that call from and by the creator to know him, to get to know him. And you know, well, I'm just thinking, you know, in terms of us being Seventh-day Adventists, as all of us or most of us are all here, how then can we show, or how can we demonstrate a witness to people who don't want to come to church? No, I don't believe in church. I don't believe in the Bible. Can we show them other pieces of evidence, other exhibits? In the same chapter, it says, in them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun. See, again, reference to the sun. Very important. Everything revolved around sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, rejoices as a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heaven and the circuit unto the ends of it, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. The majestic sun. The sun is so amazing. A ball of fire, as it were. Ball of fire. It's amazing. And that's why the Bible references the sun of righteousness, because it points people to where our lives need to revolve around. The center of our lives need to be Jesus, the sun of righteousness, just as it's modeled in the universe. So, brilliant concept, but it's there for all to see. Have we thought about that for a moment? The sun being the center of the universe and why it was placed and created that way? It's God's intentional doing. 7 through 11 goes on to build a case. It says God's glory is found in his word, undeniable evidence for God. God's glory in his word. Let's see that. So it says this, it's kind of long, but I just want to focus on this one here. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. And we keep going. In verse 8 says, the statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. And then it continues, verse 9, the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and what? Righteous altogether. Let's go to verse 10. Let's read that together. More to be desired are they than gold, a much than fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the what? Honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. So, it talks about God being revealed in his word. And then the next few verses talks about a prayer for right relationship with God in the same chapter. Prayer for a right relationship with God. And that's what God seeks through his creation, to get to know who he has created. Why does the world, we run away from God? People are afraid of God. People think God is going to punish them and it's going to, they're going to burn in hell. And so we've got to dispel that myth. We've got to disabuse people of this faulty thinking and notion. That's not what God actually runs toward us. God wants to know us. In fact, when Adam sinned in the garden, it was God that went seeking for him and Eve, not Adam. And Adam went, he was afraid, he went hiding. God came looking for him, as he comes looking for each one of us and our world. He comes looking for us, and he desires to have a relationship with us. Who can understand his errors? The next few verses. Cleanse thou me from secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. And then, that wonderful prayer. Let's read it together. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And we often say that after we pray in some of our prayers. And God desires for us to come back into a right relationship with him. And how can we have a right relationship with him? If we seek him. The Bible says in Jeremiah 29, verse 13, you shall find me when you shall seek and find, when you shall search for me with all your heart. So you've got to find God, because God is a God, a heart filled with a heart of love. And the only way that we can respond is from our heart to his heart. So, summary for the evidence for God, cause and effect. Creator, creation. Okay, there's a cause and effect. In everything that we do, there's a cause and effect relationship. You think about it, right? There's a cause for something, of course, and there's an effect of it. So we can, even when we're reasoning, we use a cause and effect approach. Even in school, when we're writing paper, there's a cause and effect relationship. What are we trying to prove? What's our thesis? So here it is. There's a creator, there's a creation. Cause and effect. Intelligent design. As we can see in our world, that the world didn't just come together with a Big Bang theory. Or we evolved from a one-cell amoeba. Or from an ape. Now, how many of you have had hard times dealing with this subject? And how do you deal with that? You're trying to talk to someone and say, oh yeah, no, we are very highly intelligent creatures, we evolved. What are some arguments you might use? I just want to open the floor right now. What are some arguments you use that you, when you engage in any dialogue, if you have, what are some things you say or would say? Yes. Yes. That's right. Good point. Let's expand on that. The concept of the aircraft and flight came from the study of physics. So Newton's third law, which says for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction force. They studied the bird, which God created. When you see a bird begins to flap its wing, what does it do? Okay, so it's flapping its wing, it's creating some energy, okay? This energy is causing a wind, but it's going down, there's a downward direction of the wind. That downward direction, when it presses down, creates an updraft, and that updraft begins to lift the bird upward, and as it flaps, it continues that motion as it propels it forward. The same concept is used in an aircraft, right? The turbines, the engines, create an effect, pulls it, generates the air, pushes it down. As it pushes down, it creates an updraft for the plane to take off into the air and soar into the air. So the same concept came from a bird. That's what they learned from Newton's third law, physics. Right there. Pookie knows what I'm talking about. She could probably explain it better as an engineer. You want to jump in? Pipe in. Please, please, please. I know I'm missing some technical jargon there, but I try to keep it in a layman's term. Yeah? But pipe in, okay, that's one thing. Anyone else? Yes, Sister June, please. Yes. Absolutely. Yes. It's so true. It's created as a whole unit, one unit. If you disconnect a member, it's going to cause a dysfunctionality, which we know. It's amazing. And even just the study of the body alone, the way it repairs, the way it regenerates itself, it only shows that there must be some supernatural intelligent design in the creation of the human body. Just the brain with billions of neurons, the 60,000 miles of blood vessels that run in our circulatory system, the 11 systems of the human body, how could it just all work in tandem and in sync? Definitely, there must be God. Vimbai, thank you. Right. You know what? It's so fun. It's interesting that you brought that up. I've used that so many times. Along the continuum of evolution, there should be gradual, gradient, and incremental changes. I have not seen anyone lately that looks like a... Sorry. I haven't seen anyone morphing between a half ape, a Homo sapien and a Homo erectus. I haven't seen it. That's a Latin term. I haven't seen it. Have you seen it? Maybe sometimes someone gets on your nerve and you might call them an ape or whatever. But they are not. We should be able to see it, right? You didn't hear what he said. You want to say it a little bit louder?
You haven't seen members of my family.
Okay. But you know, there is some resemblance in all of God's creation. Like if you think about the animal kingdom and the human beings, if you think of, there are some similarities, right? Of course. Why are we so attached to some of our pets? Like I have a dog. And sometimes my dog treats me better than some people. When I go home, my dog, even before, starts to bark, knows my presence. And then, that's one thing. Then if I look over, the tail begins to, you know, wiggle and wag, right? Because they're excited. And then when I come in physical contact, that dog jumps on me and licks me. Right? I didn't even get that treatment from some people. Anyways, I'm just kidding. I'm saying that it's amazing that there you can have, you know, there's a relationship there. It's relationship, right? And that's just a dog. Yeah, okay, it's okay. Let's leave it there. Well, that's a good relationship. Very, very wonderful, loving relationship. And that's what God designs for us. But it's amazing how we can have that relationship. Because you remember, Adam was given the task to name the animals, and he had a special relationship. Can you imagine the same names that God, that Adam gave to the animals, we still have them today? Of course, there's been, there's been speciation and a little bit of mutation and variation in God's creation, because he allowed that. He built that in our DNA. In fact, when you think about DNA, and I'm going to touch on that right now, deoxyribonucleic acid, right? It is the building blocks of life, our phenotype, the way we look physically, our physical characteristics, and our genotype, what's encoded in our DNA. So the color of your hair, the color of your eyes, the pigmentation of your skin, your height, everything about you, your features, right? It's all encoded in the DNA. I wanted to share this with you. I don't have it on this, but it just came to mind as we're talking. You know when the Bible says God wrote the law in our hearts? Well, it wasn't the physical organ that pumps 5 liters of blood per minute. No, not the heart itself, but it was encoded in our mind, but more so, it was encoded in our DNA. In our DNA. The law of God was encoded in our DNA. The truth is, every one of us has some sense of morality. Even if you've never come across the Bible, you're not a Christian, but someone knows, a child knows when they do something wrong, right? When they break something, when they steal. But of course, what happens is the reason why people lose their conscience becomes so callous is because they repeat that action, it becomes habitual, and so it begins to silence God's voice and it begins to suppress that morality. But it has always been there. That sense of doing what's right was encoded in our DNA, but when sin entered into the world, it began to slowly deteriorate and begin to expunge it from and mutated our DNA, but it's still there, a sense of goodness and right. It's there because God put it there in his creation. It's just like when a manufacturer builds something, there's a mechanism, an inbuilt mechanism. So God put an inbuilt mechanism in our DNA to turn toward God. Look at, for example, in biology, plants. There's a concept called geotropism. Have you heard of it? Geotropism. Plants are naturally inclined to grow toward the sun. In fact, we understand that they are draw energy, right? They receive the sunlight and they convert that through photosynthesis into energy for the plant to grow. So think about it. If a plant innately, inherently has that inbuilt mechanism, how about you and I? More so, the highest order of God's creation on the sixth day. It then has to be activated. Gene has to be activated. Just like I told you, Dr. Sang Lee. Do you remember Dr. Sang Lee? He's a Seventh-day Adventist physician, allergen specialist. And he said that God has a love gene. And he also talked about that Sabbath gene, and even geneticists and molecular biologists refer to it as the rest gene that is only activated on the seventh-day cycle. It's there in our bodies. It's amazing. And so that gene, when we enter into that relationship with God, return to that communion with God, that's when that gene is activated. It's there. It's dormant in each and every human being. But when we come into relationship with God, return back to the Creator, God activates that gene because it's there, that's been planted, installed, created in our DNA. Isn't that fascinating? Evidence. There's lots of evidence. We can talk more and more, but there's a lot. There's another important piece of information. Inherent within each one of us is a desire to worship something or someone. Think about it for a moment. Those who don't worship God,
they are invariably and inevitably worshiping something else. Think about it for a moment. Can you give me some examples? Yes. Thank you. Yes. Celebrities. By the way, remember I said they call themselves stars. They're not real stars. They're fallen stars. There's only one true star, the bright and morning star. But we all have a desire to worship. And so those who don't know God, they worship. We talked to touching it. Gods of, you know, idols, gods of wood, stone, and metal. Yeah, you think about it. Why? Why do people want to worship something? Why there's so many religions? Because people want to worship. They want to worship because it's instinctive within each one of us. God created it there. And that's the reason why there's a call from the Creator. It's like, well, I don't want to use this kind of poor example, but you know, it's like Transformers. You've seen, I don't want to use, you know, but I'm using it as an example, right? And Transformers, you know, there's a guy named Optimus Prime. Again, another thing that tries to create, an idea, false idea, but I'm just using the parallel. And he comes to Earth, and he says, calling all Autobots to come back. Okay, how do they respond to the call? Because there's something within them that responds to the call. Optimus Prime, his name, powerful name, he's a prime, he's Optimus, he's powerful, he's their fearless leader, courageous leader, and he calls them into action. And so, even more importantly, and beyond cartoons and fabrication, is God's call to his creation. Yes. 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 When we look at the First Nations, when we look at which I had the privilege of working there for 2.5 to 3 years, I visited some reserves. And you know what? It was amazing. I started to have a Bible study with a couple and did a presentation for a whole reserve. And I opened the floor. And of course, you know, you got to build relations. So it took a couple of months. Because they don't just talk. They're very quiet, and they don't look at you in your face or in your eyes. But after a couple of months, we had a Bible study, and they began to share that they hear and they feel God's presence through nature. They're very connected through nature. A lot of these First Nations and the natives, they're very connected through nature. And then when we bring in Jesus, and how I started was not 2300 days and Sabbath and SDA. No, I started with the creation, with the Creator, and they responded like that because there's something within them that they can resonate with. As Pastor Alex used the word, resonate. You've got to resonate. There's an internal connection that when it is activated, it makes a connection with the other source. And so that's when I talked about creation and the Creator, they were fair game. They opened up themselves. And by the way, that couple became Seventh-day Adventists. And that's up north. So God is working, and it's there in each and every one of us. So let's keep building our case. Why do people deny God? Why do people deny God? Any ideas why people deny God? Why? Thank you. They don't understand, and they don't know who God is. And so one of the last messages in this world and for this church to proclaim is not so much so our 28 fundamental doctrines. It's not all about that, because we're not going to be saved based on knowing and keeping and understanding 20. That's wonderful. That's part. But knowing God. And the last message, I think the greatest message is to be revealed and proclaimed, is a revelation of the character of God. At the end of the day, that is what people need to hear. Who is God? When they see who God is, the character of God, the loveliness of God, that is what draws people to Him. Jesus says, and I, if I be lifted up, will draw all men, women, boys and girls to me. So there's a cause and effect. There's also a cosmological argument. The universe must have an adequate cause. Let's explore that and break that down together. So cosmology comes from the Greek word cosmos, which means order, form, the world as an ordered whole. And logia, which means study. Okay? Logos or logia means study. So this is what we're looking at, cosmology, and let's break it down. Every effect has an adequate cause. In other words, something comes from something, and nothing comes from nothing. If you remember creation,
Did God have anything to work with at the beginning of creation? Do you remember? What did he have to work with? Did he? Right. The Bible says the earth was. Now, let me stop here for a moment, because some people date the earth as millions and millions of years. But it very well may be that there was a mass of protoplasm or void, like it says, void and without form. So there was perhaps a mass there, but no life was on that mass. So when we talk about the inception of life, we cannot say it was millions and millions of years ago, because life only began in the last several thousand years, which we know about six millennia, about approximately 6,000 years, could be a little bit more, give or take. And then current datings, like there's carbon dating and uranium dating, which actually dates it much less than millions. It's actually 10,000 or less, according to uranium dating and carbon dating. It's less than 10,000. So when we talk about the inception of life, that's what we're referring to. We're not talking about vast, but God basically created something out of nothing. In Latin, we call that ex nihilo, okay? Creating something out of nothing. The Hebrew word is bara. It means he created something out of nothing. He took something. Only God could do that. Everything that's created in our world is created with something. Something comes from something. A raw resource, a material, precious metal, yes. You think about gas. Well, where does gas come from? Of course, traced back to oil, right? So, but God created something from nothing. So that demonstrates who God is all by himself. God doesn't need a crutch. He doesn't need help. He is God. And so he created nothing from something from nothing. That's a distinguishing mark of who the Creator is. Cosmos exists. What is the adequate cause? Well, let's keep going together on this. So Hebrews chapter 3, 3 and 4 says this: the architect or builder of a house, family or nation is greater than itself. Cause and effect. I just want you to see the picture. Cause and effect. The architect or builder of a house, family or nation is greater than itself. Hebrews 3 verse 3 and 4 says this: for this man Christ was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as who hath builded the house hath more honor than the house. For every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. It's God. He built all things. He created all things. He's the author and finisher of our faith. He's the architect and builder of this universe. If a watch is evidence of a maker, how much more is the cosmos evidence of God? Think about that. I like watches. How many of you like watches? You know, I don't worship it, but it's one of my fancies, you know? Yes. So if I were to ask some of you what kind of watches you have, I know you don't have dollar store watches. I know some of you have some very nice watches, maybe a Rolex or a Mega or ESQ or a Movado, you know, or Citizen. Well, I'm going to share with you in closing, not now, in a few minutes, about my watch. But right now, I won't show it to you. So we'll stay on this for a little while. So there is evidence here. If you look at a watch, how complex it is. You open it up in the back, all these moving parts and components. It's like, wow, who could figure this out? A watchmaker, a master designer, a creator. Well, likewise with this world. Evidence of God. So God was the first cause. There's a law called the first law of thermodynamics. It talks about first cause. And Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. We know that. We've heard it so many times. So there is a first cause. Even scientists, when you talk to them, they always come back. There is a primary cause. There's a first cause. And it's a law in thermodynamics. There's a first cause. It is an indisputable fact. So at the end of the day, when they come back to the first cause, they come back to God waiting for them all along. I've been here waiting for you to realize this, for the light to go on, for you to have your eureka moment. In the beginning, God created the heaven and earth. That was the first cause, God the creator. And when we think about creation and its order, it's so fascinating. Which is more reasonable, the first cause, eternal God, or eternal matter?
What do you think? Eternal God. And when you think about that for a moment, I mean, matter has no life in it, right? God had to use matter and put life into it. Exactly. Let's take a look at it from this comparison here. So eternal God, intelligent. Power to will and plan. Eternal matter, non-intelligent. No power to will and plan. Eternal God, all wise. Eternal matter, no wisdom. Eternal God, infinite power. Eternal matter, no power. Eternal God, infinite love. Eternal matter, there's no love. Eternal God, infinite love and goodwill. And in eternal matter, there's no goodwill. Let me just go back there for a moment. So I hope you can see the big picture here as we make this comparison, that there is that eternal God who created us with purpose and intentionality. All right, let's keep building our case here. So, matter and energy are finite. You know, the second law of thermodynamics states this: the universe is growing old, wearing down, running down, due ultimately to burn itself out. What would we call that? What do we call that? What would we label that as? If we were to use a word that we all know of: decay, decomposition, and then what is the disease that has affected and cursed this earth? S-I-N, right there. But a second law of thermodynamics right here says it right here. Entropy, random. The universe is growing old right here. This is what scientists have proposed. It's exactly happening in our world. In fact, the Bible, do you have any evidence from the Bible that this is a fact? Can we prove this? Sure. Do you know some references in the Bible? In Isaiah, in Jeremiah, it talks about the earth growing old, waxing old like a what? Garment. It's fact in the Bible. In fact, and even in the New Testament, that one day, the earth is going to melt fervent heat. Okay? Again, it's not going to be water and flood, but it's going to be fire next time. But if we look throughout the Old Testament, it refers to the earth as growing old, as moaning and groaning. There's references in the Bible. I don't have them right here. But it's referenced in the Bible. And in fact, I believe the scientists developed the second law of thermodynamics based on their understanding of Scripture. The Bible already said it long before they came up with the second law of thermodynamics. So we know what's happening. And ultimately, God will not allow this world to destroy itself. He will intervene in the affairs of human history. Why? Because this is still God's world. He created it. This is God's property. The enemy, the devil, stakes his claim that this world is his unlawfully. He makes unfair, and he claims unfair entitlement. In fact, there's a restaurant in the U.S. called Claim Jumper. Have you heard of it? Claim Jumper. It's very interesting. If you go there, you're going to get very large sizes, large proportions of food. You get the most mileage out of your money. But Claim Jumper came from the concept of those who were looking for gold back in the 1900s, okay? And the term came from those who were conniving and those who would seize a property that did not belong to them. They would be referred to as a claim jumper. A claim jumper. So they would seize the property of someone else who already staked a claim, and they would kick them out, push them out by force, by whatever means, and they would claim that or seize that property. They were known as claim jumpers. Well, in the same light, in the same vein, that's what the devil did to God. He is a conniving claim jumper. He claims this world as his own. He claims what doesn't belong to him because he never created. He claims you and I, this world that is not under his care. Those who don't know God, he claims them as his own. He's a claim jumper, a false claim jumper. And so, therefore, here we have it, that we see what's happening with our world. It is actually deteriorating and eroding. So God is going to intervene in the affairs of this world before it destroys. He will never allow this world to have complete annihilation and obliteration. Why? Why is that? Because if he did that, what would happen? What would happen if God allowed that to happen? What would that mean? Anyone hazard a guess?
If God allowed the world to continue as it is, we do destroy ourselves. And then the false claims of the devil will be justified. So he has to disprove, because God is on trial. You know, the Creator is on trial. It's a world tribunal. And we know this, and that's why we're coming about from that macro perspective about God and the Creatorship, because we need to understand this. You know, we've heard of the term, the great controversy. Well, that's really what it's all about. God is on trial. He's been accused. He's unfair, unjust. He's unloving. He is arbitrary. He's dogmatic. And people serve him out of fear and not out of love. And that's a false claim of the enemy. And God waits for you and I to be his witnesses against those false claims and that false testimony, because that's not who God is. When we experience God, we know that he is a God of love. He's gracious. He's long-suffering. He's merciful. He's slow to anger, plenteous and merciful. And I know some of you have experienced that, if not all of you. That's the God I know. You know, it's amazing. The four corners of this earth, there are reserves. Let me actually break it down here. Let's go to 2 Peter. Can you turn your Bibles with me to 2 Peter? I want to share this with you. We're going to wrap up in the next few minutes. 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, and then we want to go to verse 12. If you found it, would you just say amen? Wonderful. It says this in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 12, looking for and hastening unto the coming day of God, wherein the heaven shall, being on fire, shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Deep in the earth's crust is like a ball of fire. And at the four corners of this earth, four conventions, north, south, east, and west, the Middle East thinks that they have all the oil. But if you think about it, we have a lot of oil in the Arctic. We have in Alberta, the oil sands, we have oil in the Arctic. We have oil in the south as well. We have oil to the east of us. We also have oil reserved to the west of us. Day is coming when God, after time has been no more, is going to allow the elements and the earth, the oil. This time, it won't be water or flood, but it'll be fire this time. Will be activated. It says the elements shall melt with fervent heat. I believe God has placed strategically there his own reserve, so that when God comes to make all things new, renews the earth, he will use the resources that he created in the first place that's already been there. God has it reserved. That's the wisdom of God. We talk about the wisdom of God. 2 Peter 3:10 says God will destroy the universe when its purpose is finished. So it cannot perpetuate itself, because he is the creator. He can create, he can destroy, and he can recreate. So that's evidence right there of the creator's workmanship. Creator's workmanship. Okay? Let us keep going. Okay? This is the text before. Did I just read that? No, I read verse 12. It says, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. So it's not, as I said, water and flood, but it's fire next time, right? Fire is coming. And that's what God has reserved after its purpose, his purpose is complete, after God's character is vindicated. And then he makes all things new. Only the Creator God can actually do that. That is so amazing. So intelligent design by intelligent designer. And here's a word called teleology. Teleology. And it says, the Greek teleos says end, purpose, design. And again, logia means study. Okay? So this is the study of design and purpose. Let's explore it a little bit more. The universe reflects order and design, not random chance. It is cosmos, not chaos. It's cosmos, not chaos. That's how God created. In fact, he created, again, something out of nothing. And so he took chaos and he made the cosmos. And it's not the opposite way around, because there's end and purpose in his grand design, in his master scheme. The universe functions in an orderly, systematic, and productive way. We know that, as we can see, Genesis 1, he created everything in sequence, in order, from day 1 to day 6. Think about it, right? Why didn't he create you and I first? Why didn't he create the animals before the sun and the galaxy? No, because everything builds on each other. There's a symbiotic relationship that exists, that everything is interconnected in God's creation. It's not a separate entity, as some people believe. You can't live in a glass bubble. Everything is connected. And that's the order. We won't go through it, but we know the order of creation. How God created everything of it after its kind, after their kind, after their kind, so that it can support and sustain life. We were created to perpetuate life. This world was created to sustain itself. And we got to say, wow, it's done a good job despite all the pollution, contamination, and destruction that we have created in this world. You think about it for a moment. Isn't it a big issue right now, global warming, right? We have conferences and summits on how to protect the environment, how to preserve the environment. We already know that so many things have been done by our own creation. We are a product of the environment. We've also destroyed our own living habitat as well. But yet, despite all the abuse, the earth is still able to sustain itself. We're still able to breathe fresh air. Though some of our air might be tainted, but God has a way of cleaning up, right? Cleaning up the entire air through the whole transpiration process and the whole hydrologic cycle. It's amazing how God has designed this world to sustain life for you and I. And it just shows the order. Okay, and I just want to quickly go through this. So while the earth remains seed time and harvest and cold and heat and summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. God set the cycles and seasons of nature to sustain life because he did it that way. If he didn't, if we could just evolve that way, it would be amazing. But there's no way it could evolve with such precision and such intelligent design. We see intelligent design throughout God's entire creation. Order, systematic, and of course, self-perpetuating, sustaining. That's God. Okay, let's keep going. It says here, nature functions in a sequence to sustain life. The question is, why? 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 Let's explore it. It says in Psalm 147, 7 and 9, sing unto the Lord with thanksgiving, sing praise upon the harp unto our God, who covers the heavens with clouds, who prepares rain for the earth, who makes grass to grow upon the mountains. He gives to the beasts his food and to the young ravens which cry. The earth, okay, so let's stay right there for a moment. So we see that God created everything to sustain life. How does a bird know to go and feed its young? How do they survive? You know, Darwin tried to come up with the concept of survival of the fittest. But if the animals know how to survive, think about it. We know how to survive even more. Survival of the fittest, think about it. They find food, they live. How about us? We know how to survive. Because God has put that within us. He built it in our system. Let's go on to the next window of evidence here. The earth is tilted at the right angle, 23 degrees, to sustain life. Now, you know the earth rotates on its axis. 365. The earth is moving right now. What if someone just spun it a little faster? I have a little globe at home, and I think of it. If you know, you play with it a little bit, and I said, "Wow! If I did that, and if something were to happen, and this globe, if this Earth was to spin a little faster, we all would be dizzy. We'd be falling off the face of planet Earth. We'd be falling into the ocean. Think about it. It rotates consistently since God set it in motion from the beginning of time. It has been rotating on its axis, in its orbit." And of course, ultimately orbiting around the sun. But it's tilted at 23 degrees to sustain life. 24 or 26 wouldn't cut it. We could not sustain life exactly where it has been set. That's where it has been since the beginning of time, since the beginning of creation to the present time. Evolve, evolution? Yeah, right. Far chance, or they say fat chance, can't happen. 23 degrees, God set it in motion. Just the right degree so that life can be sustained on this earth. The earth rotates once per day on its axis, the right speed, 1,040 miles per hour, 1,670 kilometers per hour, and orbits the sun once per year. At the right speed, 18.5 miles per second, 30 kilometers per second to sustain life. Right down to the science. Now, it's amazing that astronomers and scientists could actually come up with these specifications. And why can't they see that there is an intelligent designer, supernatural design? You're telling me that that just happened by evolution? It would take millions of years for evolution to get that right on the spot, bang on, spot on. Trial and error would take forever. God didn't need to do trial and error. One time, one word, he spoke it into existence. Spoke it into existence. That's power, right? God created everything in his creation, except for one of his creation that he did not speak into existence, and that's you and I. God stooped down. God bent down. That's to tell you how much we mean to God. In fact, I remember reading a quotation from Spirit of Prophecy says that in, I can't remember, oh, it's in Spiritual Gifts. It says that we are a specimen of Jehovah. We are a specimen of Jehovah. You know, in science, you remember that they would study specimens, right, as samples and all that. And also, when we go for surgeries and tests, they take a biopsy. Well, likewise, that biopsy, we are a specimen of Jehovah. God took his time, stooped down, and he formed us and fashioned us with his own hands. What does that tell us about how much God values us, how much God loves us? I mean, that is special care and attention. Only a God of love would do that. So here it is. The earth rotates once per day on its axis. Isn't that brilliant? Right speed. Without that, there'd be no life. We would all die. We would all die instantly. Suffocate. Our lungs would collapse. We wouldn't be able to sustain life on this earth. Infinite and intelligent design. Okay, so the sun is the right temperature. Surface, 10,000 degrees Fahrenheit, 5,600 degrees Celsius. The core is 27 million degrees Fahrenheit, or 15 million degrees Celsius. And the distance, we talked about it, 93 million miles away, or 150 million kilometers from Earth to sustain life. That is precision. It doesn't get better than that. You talk about perfection and precision right here in God's creation. Can you imagine? Again, as I said, if the sun was any closer, the earth was any closer, we'd all be scorched. This place would be an oven. We'd be baking. And then, if it was any further, we'd be freezing. We'd be like Antarctica times 100 or 1,000. So God put it exactly where it needed to be to sustain life. He's an amazing God, a wonderful God. There's more than enough evidence that proves God's existence. The moon is the right distance from the earth. Elliptical, oval orbit, 221,463 miles. And then, of course, 251 and 968 miles to sustain life. If the moon was any closer, we'd experience also tidal waves. The oceans would be affected because, right, the tidal waves in the oceans are in relation with the position of the moon and the earth. And likewise, if it was further away, we would also experience hypothermia, and this place would be a barren land. So the way God has set it up, there is what we call a symbiotic relationship in all of his creation, and that includes you and I. That's amazing. God is fascinating, and his ways are past finding out. The earth's atmosphere, bubble of air, affects temperature and weather. Is the right thickness, 248 miles, to sustain life. You know, you hear about the ozone layer being depleted, the ozone layer? Well, that's serious, right? Once that ozone layer is fully depleted, the UV rays, the ultraviolet rays that are being emitted from the sun, of course, that's what it's saying, that you need to put sunblock, don't go in on the sun for too long. They give you a suggested time. Why? Because if that's the case, then of course we would contract many diseases. We can get heat stroke and we can, our heart, it can affect our whole physiological functioning. So, perfect position with the Earth's atmosphere. It's God. Intelligent design. Let's keep going. Almost done. The Earth's crust is the right thickness. 6 miles. Oceanic, 35 miles. Continental to sustain life. Did it just evolve like that? Who designed this? Took a great God to design with precision, to think of everything. Who would have thought of that? Just the right calculation. And guess what? It's amazing. What I love is that God allows us, human beings, scientists, physicists, biologists, to see the evidence and even calculate it, to measure it, and then for them to come to their own conclusions. There must be a God. There must be a God. The oceans are the right depth. Average 2.6 miles. Deepest 7 miles to sustain life. Any deeper, any shallow, could not even sustain aquatic life as well. Who thought of this? Our great God. That's why we sing how great He is, how great Thou art. Animals, instincts sustain life. Young herrings, gulls tap a red spot on the parent's beak to be fed. Instinctive within them. God put that red beak there as an indicator for them to be fed. Divine design. And there's other examples. Can anyone share any examples from the animal kingdom? Anyone can see any intelligent design in any of the animal kingdom? Anyone like to suggest anything that comes to mind? Yes. Buki, and then... Oh yeah, Buki, yes, go ahead. And then we'll come to you. Absolutely. Have you ever seen a pack of geese before? I know you all don't like geese. I know they're very messy and they try to get rid of them, right? But geese are intelligent. And when they're flying south, they form in a V shape, a V formation. Now, why do you think they do that? Who taught them that? Exactly. Powerful aerodynamic concept. They conserve as much energy as possible so they can fly even further. Okay, another point on that. Yes. That's right. Instinctive. That's intelligent design right there. Geese formation. And you know what? Just to build on that is that they help one another because the strongest goes to the front. And guess what? As they flap their wings, those at the back that are weaker ride on the updraft of their production of energy so that it helps them to stay in the pack. And then when the one at the front gets tired, the one at the front goes to the back and takes its formation in the back. And the stronger one that's been riding on the updraft now leads the pack so that the other one can get some energy to continue on the journey. That's brilliant. Imagine if we had the sense of geese. Anyways, let's go on. I see Brother Kai. Yes, go ahead. He took yours. Salmon is spawning upstream. Brilliant. Brilliant. That is God. That is God. That is God. Okay, and there's another word, ontology, really quickly, and it's evidence of God's existence, man's unique capacity to seek, love, and worship God. We talked about that instinctive desire in each one of us to love God. Okay, and I want to quickly go through that. God created us in His own image. In the image of God created He Him. Male and female created He them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. It's amazing. When I go to zoos, how many of you visited, like to go to visit zoos? Zoos are fascinating. And isn't it amazing how they can tame tiger or a lion or even a killer whale? You know, you go to marine. Isn't it amazing how we can learn, even those that, you know, work with insects and reptiles. It's fascinating. Like, that's not something I would like to do personally, but I like to see it, though. I like to observe. And as I look from a distance, it's amazing how that there can be that relationship and how God's established it from the very beginning of time, that there would be a special relationship between us and God's other creation, that we were meant to take care of God's creation. We're meant to be stewards of God's creation. But sin has caused that, you know, that flight or flight response and that fear so that when animals see us, they're not so much they're afraid of us, but out of fear they instinctively defend themselves. They run away or they try to defend themselves. It was never meant to be that way. And then, of course, the existence of the belly implies food. And this is an interesting one. It's so funny. But God created us to nourish ourselves so that we can replenish ourselves and sustain life. God created us. Think about that digestive system. You just had lunch. Wasn't that a good lunch you just had? A great lunch, right? And the lunch, can you imagine what happens from the time food enters our mouth and it goes down to a digestive system? You know, digestion begins here, goes right down, and it's able to metabolize and to digest all that food and extract the nutrients that we need. The energy converts it into energy for our bodies, for our muscles. Fascinating. God created us to sustain life. I want to wrap up really quickly now. Okay, so the existence of some things is evidence of corresponding things. So this corresponds to that. Male corresponds to female. Belly responds to food. Our bodies to God's purpose. We seek eternity. God is there. It's just showing that kind of parallel relationship that God created. We talk about parallelism even today in the Bible, from Exodus to Revelation. So there is order. What I wanted to show you is, demonstrate, is there's an order, there's a sequence, there's a flow. Our capacity for God, God exists. He created us for His purpose, for His honor, for His glory. And of course, why do people deny God? It's because they don't know Him. They're ignorant to the truth. There is a sense of ingratitude and pride that leads them astray. And so, of course, that leads to ignorance. And I'm just kind of going through this really quickly, but just for us to get the essentials here. Okay, so we talked about that essentially. And some close their eyes to evidence. While there is so much amazing visible evidence, people close their eyes because they are afraid of God. And God doesn't want us to be afraid of Him. He wants us to know Him. And that's why this is how we want to present to the community. People who don't know God, we want to show them who God is. First, He is a God of love, the Creator of heaven and earth, that desires our good, our well-being, and our eternal welfare. The love of sin is the root cause, okay? Denying God eases people's conscience sometimes. And so people just stay away from God. And you know that wonderful, well, not wonderful, but that famous quote in Psalm 14 says, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God." And they say there is no God because they ignorantly, blindly deny the evidence that is before them. They don't even want to consider or entertain the evidence that's before them. So in conclusion, the universe reveals that God exists. The heavens declare the glory of God. Summary of evidence for God: cause and effect, creator and creation, intelligent design, which we went through this afternoon, man's capacity, our capacity to worship something greater and beyond ourselves, also proves that God exists. And why do people deny God? It's because they blind themselves, are ignorant to God's will and purposes and the evidence that surrounds them. God then patiently awaits sinners and all of us to seek Him so that they can know His will for their lives. And then, of course, God sent the Savior. And He said unto them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned." And that's not God's will. He doesn't want anyone to perish. In fact, when we read in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, it says this. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. "The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some men count slackness, but is longsuffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." God's desire is to save the entire human family. Think about it. 7 billion plus people. Is it possible that everyone can be saved? Yes. Will everyone choose to be saved? No, we don't. We know that, unfortunately. But we do all that we can to demonstrate and to exonerate and to exemplify God's character of love. So we're coming back to that today. CSI. Cross-scene investigation. And there is evidence at the cross when Jesus died. When I read his article from a coroner, this is what he suggested. This coroner, When Jesus was on the cross, and we talked about what happened on the cross, a few things happened. Number one, when he died, his body was suspended and his extremities were nailed to that cross. So one of the reasons why he died was because of the extremities, and that caused, you know, respiratory fatigue and failure. And as a result of that, he was experiencing what we know as when someone's suffocating, asphyxia and slow heart failure. The second piece of evidence on the CSI at the cross was exposure to the elements. It was windy, it was cold, it was raining and storming, so he was exposed to these elements as he was essentially naked and hanging there, bleeding, open wounds. The third piece of evidence was, I think I touched on it, was dehydration. He could have died of dehydration. But the fourth one is that he literally bled to death. When his side was punctured, the pericardial sac was punctured that protects and encases the heart, was punctured, he actually bled to death. And more importantly, I think he died of the broken heart for you and I, because he took our sins and the sins of the world in order to save us. And so for perhaps 24 to 48 hours, it's able to charge up and to last for up to 6 months. But if I keep it in a dark place and I hide it from the light, it's not going to function properly. It was built and designed to function to be in the presence of light. And I thought about it for a moment, and I'm making the application. You and I were designed by our loving Creator to live in the presence of light and His love. If we do not remain in His light and His love, then we operate in darkness, and then we begin to wither and we begin to die. But you and I were designed to be in the sunshine of His presence and His righteousness. So I want to challenge you today as we close that we will live in His presence daily by His grace and power. And if that's your heart's desire, I'm going to invite you to stand as we close our session with prayer.